Hello and welcome to the program. I'm your host, Neil Howard, here on Health Professional Radio. So glad that you could join us for another segment. In a surprising twist, recent studies now show that men are making up a very growing proportion of individuals suffering from eating disorders like anorexia and bulimia. Eating disorders are traditionally considered to be mainly affecting women. However, some experts believe the prevalence and severity of this problem may be spiking even more for women and men due to the anxiety and stress surrounding, of course, the COVID-19 pandemic. Well, National Eating Disorders Week is coming up. It's scheduled from February the 22nd through the 28th. It's aimed at educating the public about the problem of eating disorders while providing hope and support and visibility to those who are affected. Well, joining us now with more on this important issue and advice on how to help those impacted is returning guest Dr. Melissa Spann, Chief Medical Officer at Montanito. It's a treatment center for eating disorders. Welcome back, Doctor. How have you been?
Doing well. Thanks for having me back.
Well, for our listeners who may not be familiar with you as a contributor, give us a little bit of insight into your professional background and then tell us about this increase in men now impacted by eating disorders.
Sure. So I am the chief clinical officer of one of the nation's leading residential eating disorder programs. We have over 30 facilities across the country treating people of all genders. So what we know is that eating disorders historically have been seen as perhaps a white, middle-class female disorder. And eating disorders affect people of all genders, races, religion, ethnicity, orientations, body weight, shape, and sizes. So the national surveys now estimate that 20 million women and 10 million men in America will have an eating disorder at some point in their lives.
Is it normally due to stress, some type of stress, or are there genetic components to eating disorders?
There are so many factors to the onset and development of eating disorders. We take an approach that we would say it's a biopsychosocial approach, in which there are certainly biological factors, those innate characteristics we're born with, psychological factors, things that go on in our social environment, and those sociocultural factors, which is those environmental triggers. So there's a lot of different factors that contribute to the onset of eating disorders. What we know is that through the course of the last couple of years in facing this pandemic, that in times of stress, people who were struggling got worse. So people with anorexia had more severe restriction. People with bulimia and binge eating disorder experienced more episodes of binge eating. And in general, people who struggled with eating disorders or disordered eating, even in its more mild forms, really escalated throughout the pandemic.
You know, I once heard an analogy about men and women and health conditions. You know, a man and a woman are in a restaurant. The woman is having a heart attack. She lets everyone in the restaurant know I'm in distress. She gets saved. The man is having a heart attack, excuses himself, goes to the bathroom and dies in the john. Mm-hmm. 20 million women, 10 million men. Are women saying certain things, asking certain questions, as opposed to men? It's just now being revealed that men are affected as well.
Men probably have very similar rates of eating disorders, but now we're talking about it more. So some of the statistics say that males represent 25% of individuals who have anorexia nervosa. And to your earlier point, they are at higher risk of dying, in part because they are diagnosed later, since people make assumptions that males perhaps don't have eating disorders. And so that stigma associated with eating disorders prohibits people from seeking care because of stereotypes or perceptions around who is impacted by an eating disorder.
We mentioned stress earlier in our conversation as a contributing factor to eating disorders. Are there certain factors that have been revealed that affect men as opposed to women or vice versa beyond what the COVID-19 pandemic presents as a stressor?
So some of the instances around males in particular with eating disorders suggest that men tend to turn to more dangerous means to change their weight or physical appearance. So they're bulking up, they're engaged in really excessive types of exercise. And so we do see that there are some slight differences in the literature around that. In addition, again, it's the stigma and the shame and the isolation that men often face that not only delays treatment, but in delaying treatment leads to more significant disorders longer term.
I've heard eating disorders compared to addiction. What about willpower? I understand about chemical addiction, the psychological and the chemical addiction. Is food eating disorder the exact same thing, the exact same mechanisms?
It's not the same thing, but there are certainly similarities. From an addiction-based model, we might take an abstinence-based perspective. The reality is with eating disorders, not only are we not taking an abstinence-based perspective, we're saying we're going to introduce you to the substance that you're struggling with multiple times a day. In fact, our recommendation is 6 times a day, 3 meals and 3 snacks to keep you eating throughout the day. And so in that sense, it is really a different sort of perspective from an addiction. Mm-hmm. But again, sort of the similarities are present.
What are some of the best coping techniques that you recommend for your clients, your patients?
So coping skills and in general skill development is by far the best thing that individuals can do to help themselves. And the most significant coping skill that I like to talk to people about is connection. And that's not often seen as a coping skill, but in order to challenge people from their isolation and the significant turning inward and turning towards eating disorder, we need to reach out to people instead of the eating disorder. So connection is really key. Through that is setting healthy boundaries, building strong communication skills, and certainly developing additional practices around self-care. Mindfulness-based practices are really at the core of that work.
With the stigma that you mentioned surrounding it, especially for men, how do you educate family and friends in order to be able to help you when you do reach out? I mean, you're not talking about reaching out only to healthcare providers, are you?
No, certainly not. It's certainly reaching out to the people in your life who are going to be your support system. That is the most significant connection. So for family and friends, we really want to talk about being honest, educating yourself as much as you can about eating disorders, and to be caring. One of the other factors, particularly with men, is removing the potential stigma associated with eating disorders. So reminding them that there is no shame and that people struggle with eating disorders or other mental health issues. And ultimately, just being there, being an honest sounding board and directing them towards help.
With National Eating Disorders Week coming up very soon, what is the key takeaway that you'd like this our listening audience to keep in mind when dealing with this topic, and where can we go and learn more?
So overall, the biggest takeaway is that eating disorders are treatable mental health disorders. Early intervention is certainly key, but getting help is the best way to combat an eating disorder. You can certainly go, as you mentioned, Eating Disorder Awareness Week to the National Eating Disorder Association and to our website at Montanito.com.
I appreciate you returning, Dr. Spann. Thank you so much for your time, and I'm looking forward to our next conversation.
Great. Great to connect with you.
You've been listening to Health Professional Radio. I'm your host, Neil Howard, in conversation with returning guest Dr. Melissa Spann. Audio copies of this program are available at hpr.fm and healthprofessionalradio.com.au. You can also subscribe to the podcast on iTunes, listen in, download at SoundCloud, and be sure and subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/healthprofessionalradio.